So Greg, the cannabis sector, of course, is getting a lot of attention, a lot of investor interest in this sort of up and down environment, what it could be. But you've been investing in this space for a long time now, and we've spoken a lot about it as we've developed ideas around it. What do you look for in a company in this space, especially given this is a brand new developing area?
Well, I think there's a lot of change coming in the sector because for a while everyone was talking about the sector and how big an opportunity it is, and everyone just wanted a piece of it, and they were throwing money at any idea that was out there. And it was kind of interesting that there weren't that many ways to invest in the space. So for a while, Canopy was the only play in town. So a lot of people put money towards them. As it's broadened out, I think it's an exciting time coming because you're going to get a lot of winners and losers, and it's going to really differentiate. And a lot of people are scrambling to see who's going to win from this because a lot of money's been thrown for exposure to the sector, but not everyone's going to win.
So in October, the legalization of recreational cannabis is going to come to Canada. Why is this an interesting time for active money managers who are focusing on the space and even for investors? How is this all going to play out?
Well, what happens is I think a lot of companies are actually a little worried once it actually does start legalizing because a lot of companies aren't going to be ready. A lot of companies have focused on growing and their capacity just isn't there yet. So once it actually does go to the rec market, it's going to come out to who are the real companies, who can keep the store shelf stocked, who can keep product there, and who can produce at a lower cost to actually make some money. Because prices are going to drop in the sector quite fast, and it's not every sector is going to win.
Well, one of the things actually will be brand. And as you know, in our business and in general, brand starts to become a very important component. Will the cannabis sector, as it goes recreational, will brand actually become a relevant topic, a differentiation between those who are just kind of call it wholesale growers versus those who are actually selling and getting attention with the consumer?
Absolutely. I think that's the biggest risk right now in the sector is that everyone is so focused on growing, they're not developing brands. And that's what the government, I think, has to work on because the way they've regulated, everyone with the plain paper packaging, it's going to be hard to get a brand created. And if you look at the alcohol and tobacco industry, no one cares who's growing tobacco or who's growing the hops for the beer. It's all about the brands. And I think the biggest risk for the Canadian LPs in the cannabis space right now is that they just become farmers and they don't create the brands, and the brands are going to be created in the US. And that's, I think, where the Canadian companies really need to figure out how to create brands.
So with this, what are some of your best ideas? And are you actually looking at brands south of the border as opposed to some of the Canadian growers?
Yeah, we're starting to. The Canopy is the best company as far as salon creating brands and creating the full soup to nuts scale. They are doing the Med Relief, which was acquired by Aurora, has also done a good job creating some brands. But the rest of the guys are really just focusing on growing the best weed. And I think that's a losing strategy at the end of the day. The Americans are great at creating brands. So we are starting to look south of the border at companies which are trading at much discounted multiple, but also look like they have better opportunities to create brands which are going to win at the end of the day.
Will ultimately the big opportunity in this space come when the U.S. gets this and kind of legalizes it? Is Canada and the marketplace for Canada going to become a big enough environment for these companies with these massive multiples?
Yeah, the U.S. is really where it's going to win at the end of the day. But none of the really big companies in Canada are even going to the U.S. given the threat of it's still illegal as a Schedule I drug. So they're focused more on Europe and Australia right now. Really, the U.S. is going to be where people will win and lose. But it's really not figured out yet because it's still a Schedule I drug. It's hard to get banking. It's hard to grow between states. So the U.S. is hard. But once they actually do legalize, we know how they can take over industries. So that's why it's exciting as a Canadian right now. There's not that many sectors worldwide where Canadians have the ability to dominate, and this has the chance to become one. But we've got a short window until the Americans are open and thrown upon the world that they can dominate.
Now, Greg, you actually run our innovation strategy as well as our marijuana strategy, and oftentimes we're hearing about blockchain, Bitcoin, marijuana in the same sentences these days. Is that actually, are these in any way, should they be considered and linked in any possible ways in terms of growth potentials, risk profiles for an investor today?
It's probably similar along the risk profiles, but I don't think they're really that comparable at the end of the day. They're sectors that have got a lot of media attention, but really the cannabis space is more evolved. It's been actively legal in different countries for a number of years from the medical side, and it's really just the rec market that's growing up, so you're getting a lot of excitement about it. The blockchain area, I think, is still something that's a few more years away, and it's more in a concept stage. So I think there's a little more risk in that area. The cannabis space definitely has more of a valuation risk. I think the blockchain area still has more execution risk.
Greg, let's talk a little bit about volatility and also valuation enhancements and changes in the last 12, 18 months.
Sure. So if you look at this chart, which is the enterprise value to EBITDA of the sector over the last few years, well, you can see that the space really took off from last summer into the last December. And that's really as people got excited that California was going legal. And there's a lot of people saying, well, Canada's going to go legal in 18. And just so much money came flying in that we saw these companies go from 6 to 8 times valuations to 23 times EV to EBITDA, which is really insane. And that's so far out the risk spectrum. They've had a big collapse pulling back in April and May. And I think now we're starting to normalize, we're going to start seeing the winners and losers separate. And I think it's coming back to more a fair level valuation for what the opportunity is in the space.
When you dig into these numbers and you go down to the winners and losers, maybe like who's actually winning and who's losing in your opinion the way you look at it?
Well, I think what you're really seeing is that this initial run in December to January, almost all the companies were doing exactly the same thing. And what we're showing here are some of the larger cap and some of the smaller cap companies. What we've seen in the last move up in the last few weeks is that the larger cap companies are winning and the smaller cap companies are still lagging. And I think that's creating an interesting opportunity that we're looking at to see, do we want to look at those small cap companies for valuation opportunities as they're going to be the next winners or they're going to be the acquisition targets?
Over the last couple of months, we've started to see some of the banks who had been a little cautious in this space, providing credit and taking underwriting deals, all of a sudden started to play a little bit of a bigger role. Is that actually going to legitimize some of the industry beyond the government?
Yeah.
And also bring some of the institutional investors who have, for the most part, stayed away from this space into the investment suite?
That's a big opportunity, I think, right now. Because for the last 2 years, really anyone that's investing in the space is either a retail investor or a hedge fund. And the big banks and the big mutual funds haven't really been involved, which has created some really interesting trading patterns in the stocks because it's not an efficient market. As an active manager, I look for pockets of inefficiencies, and this space has been outstanding for finding that. Now the banks are coming in. We've had BMO get involved, and we're doing the underwriting for Canopy. We've had a TD do a debt deal. And I think with that, the whole space is moving up cap. It's getting more institutions involved, and it's getting Americans involved too. So I think the gains we saw in the space last year are kind of going to be the anomaly, and it's going to go back to normal growth market. But the banks coming in is a massive deal for the Canadian market.
Now, last question. When we think a little bit about this space from a retail investor perspective, a lot of people, there are traders out there, as you say, trying to take advantage of the anomalies. But then there's also lots of people who are wondering, like, is this an area that I want to invest, in my RSP or my retirement portfolio and hold on to? And is it a space that I can just pick one or two names and hold on to for the next 5 years and I'm going to win?
No, I think it's too early to tell right now. There's still too many changes in regulation, and we don't know who is going to be the winner really at the end of the day. So I wouldn't say it's a buy and hold by any stretch. It's such a volatile space. I think you want to be in and out of the space, moving between companies, and I think there's a massive round of consolidation coming because there's too many companies in the space. So I think you want to take an active approach to the space. You want to be constantly monitoring it, and making sure you're on the right side of the trade because there's been too much money just blindly thrown at the sector that not everyone's going to win. So you want to make sure you're on the right side of the trade.